I'm going to come forward for a children's sermon. Some of you older kids come this morning too. Ann and I, do you mind coming up? Guys, come on up. Because I want to talk to you about something that maybe you older ones will understand a little bit better. When I was growing up, we had a thing at our house called a promise box. And every morning, my mother would open the box and take out a card, and it would always be a promise. So I'm just going to read one. I'm kind of give you an idea of how this worked. This promise said, "Ask and it shall be given you, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened to you." And that's Matthew 7:7. Now, a promise box, what it does is, it's filled with God's promises. So what this promise says is, if you ask God for anything, if it's His will, you're going to get it. And seek, and you shall find, knock, and the door be open to you. All right? So that's a promise. And then this one, this promise I really, really love. And I think this is a lot of people here's favorite verse. It says, "I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength." Now, do you believe that? Do you believe that God gives you strength and you can do all things? And then Mom would always on occasion add a few things, like this one. "Stop crying or I'll give you something to cry about." Any of you ever heard that one? Trent, you ever heard that one? And then my dad would always say, "Cowboy up." Well, I didn't know what that meant, but I think I do now. And then I used to have a saying that I would say, "You slammed that door and hurt its feelings. You apologize to the door. And sorry, don't feed the bulldog." I had a boy that used to say, I'd say, "Did you do that?" And he'd say, "Sorry." And I'd say, "Sorry, don't feed the bulldog. You go apologize." But then this was my favorite. "I brought you into this world and I can take you out." Jessica, did you ever hear those words? Nope, but the boy did. And this is found in Mom 3:16. Now, the promise box was something that I grew up with, and I learned God's promises very young in my life. I want you to understand something, and it's very important. God has given us promises throughout His Word, and those promises are real. And if God makes a promise, He's going to keep it. The promise I'm going to talk about today is this promise: I am coming back. That's His promise. Jesus is coming back. You believe that, Grant? You believe it? Ann and I? Trent, you believe that? Jesus is coming back. I don't know when, but I know for sure it's going to happen because He promised it. Learn the promises. You can still buy the promised scriptures. Talk to your parents about that, because it was very helpful as I was growing up, because my mom helped me realize the promises of God will always come true. Let's pray. Lord, thank You for these boys and girls, and may they understand You can stand on the promises. In Your name I pray, Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. It's good to be with you guys and come into this time of praise and worship. Our verse this morning is John 16:33 that says, "I have told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart, I have overcome the world." And I just love these words that Jesus shares. He knows that His time on earth was becoming limited, but He knew what he had hoped for. He knew why He came, and He knew what He was bringing to us while He was here, is salvation and hope, that what we have right now it fails in comparison to the love and joy and the eternal life that we have through Jesus Christ. For that, that gives us should give us a heart of praise, a heart of joy, that what we have now, it may seem hard, it may seem difficult, but it fails in comparison to the love and the joy and the eternal life that we have in heaven with him. So you stand with us now for a time of praise and worship.
Power to speak.
seated for our last song. As we can continue just singing, just how wonderful He is. That for us to see this and have the hope, it takes a part of us that we have to surrender. We have to surrender to His will, to His love, to His grace. What says in Scripture is that is His promise never turns up void, that we can trust that it is going to be fulfilled. Thank you. worship and praise your name. The Lord, we give you thanks and we give you all the glory that, Lord, that what we see and face on this planet, Lord, that fails in comparison to the future and the bright hope that we have in you. That, Lord Jesus, you came to this earth to give us this hope that never fails, that never fades away, Lord, and we just ask that we may just surrender to you and to take it. Take your victory, take your grace. And we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
You have any praise items you want to lift up? All right, let me go to prayer concerns. Lucy is having knee surgery this Thursday. Now, the good news is Nurse Ladd will be there to take care of her. Huh? Scary, yeah. Okay. Jennifer Fries has had several episodes this week. And then to kind of make matters just a little worse, their son, Jonathan, I don't know what happened. He fell or something. He cut his leg pretty bad, and they had to have quite a few stitches put in. So it's like, man, when it rains, it pours sometimes, and that's the way it works. So anything you guys have that you want to add, let's go ahead and pray. Lord, this is just a touch. Here's all it is of the concerns we have. But I know that Lucy is having this surgery coming up, and I know that she's going to be down for a while. I pray that you'd be with her. I really pray that everything in this surgery goes well and that she recovers quickly. I know it's really hard for her to sit, but the good thing is if she's sitting, she can be quilting or doing something, and I thank you for that fact that she does love to do that kind of stuff. I pray for Jennifer and Brian and Jonathan. Pray for this family, Lord. Know that this has been a rough week for Jennifer. And they are not getting any answers. And it's so frustrating. Just pray that you'd be with them. Pray that you'd be with Quinn, Rhonda, Ryan, all those that really have special needs right now. Pray for Bobby as he's needing dialysis and he still has to wait for it. Pray that you'd be with him. Lord, I know that I'm going to miss someone, but I know that it seems like we've been hit awfully hard with different things. I am so thankful that Henry is here and has been able to get through. This COVID really got him this time, Lord, and he has been so weak. And I know he's been down for at least 2 weeks, and thank you that he's doing better. And just pray that you would be with each and every one in this congregation and help us to remember some of those promises. You will be with us always. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
This morning we'll be singing in page 747 in the hymn to lead us into a time of offering. We'll sing verses 1 and 2 together.
Lord, we do praise you, and as we sing the doxology, we recognize that you are our God, and our praises, our gifts, it's all to lift up and glorify you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
We'll be singing page 781 together, verses 1 and 4. Face to face with Christ my Savior, face to face, what will it be? When the rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ who died for me, face to face I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky.
Good morning. You know, I'm kind of a simple guy. I like things black and white, straightforward, no beating around the bushes. I like things put to you in a way you can understand, not something you really have to think about or dwell on. And because of that, I really like the book of Ecclesiastes. It was credited to being written by Solomon. Solomon, he was a guy that was greatly blessed by God in both riches and wisdom. And in that book, he writes about the blueprint of how to live our lives in this world. You know, Solomon had the wisdom and the means to experience anything that his heart desired. He found in his seeking of the world's desires and the material things of this world that it was all emptiness. He called it vanity. And the original word for vanity, I'm not going to try and pronounce, it's above my pay grade. But the general meaning of it is that it's like a breath, it's like a vapor. Here one second, gone the next, and really has no impact on the environment around it. And you know, as Solomon seek all the pleasures of the world, built paradises for himself, had it all at his fingertips, he found it all emptiness. And he goes on to tell us that nothing new is under the sun. We live our lives, we strive for the same things that people did generations before us, century before us. And if we choose to fill our hearts with the things of the world, we will repeat the same thing. We will get the same results. You know, he says, there's a time for everything. There's a time for birth. There's a time for death. There's a time for weeping. There's a time for laughter. There's a time to destroy, a time to build, a time to hate, a time to love. And on he tells us. The picture seems bleak and seems depressing if you just look at it from a carnal point of view. But the message and the hope he gives us is found in Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verses 24 and 25. There is nothing better for a man than to eat and drink and tell him his labor is good. This I have seen, that is from the hand of God. And this is the important one. For who can eat and who can drink and have enjoyment without God? Though we live in a world under the curse, Solomon tells us our relationship with our Heavenly Father will provide the joy that we all seek, even in times of trouble. Jesus' death on the cross not only provided the opportunity to spend eternity free from that curse, but gave us an avenue to a relationship with God that through the Holy Spirit we may have this joy both in our mountaintop experiences, but also, and most importantly, in our valleys. The world tempts with pleasures and material things, but delivers emptiness. Christ provided joy despite our circumstances. I'll leave you with this. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Jesus Christ.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we do give thanks for all that you have done for us. Prayers that have been answered, healing that has occurred, and for your continued presence in our life. Help us to be the messengers to those others who have not heard or have not taken into their heart your word. Let them come around this table as we come around this table to partake of the cup and the loaf representing your shed body, your shed blood and broken body, that we might have eternal life. Let us share that message with others. Let us be that light in this dark world. We ask all this in thy Son's name. Amen.
Turn, if you will, this morning to Malachi, and you go, well, where is that? Right before Matthew. Malachi is the last book in the Old Testament. And what I'm going to talk about today is, first of all, I believe that every book is put in the place it's put in for a particular reason. God did it exactly the way He wanted it. And so Malachi is the last book. And so Malachi, this minor prophet, is given words that say, I want you to tell my people that I am coming. And so we have Malachi. Then all of a sudden we have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John who tell us about Jesus' first coming. But Malachi is also talking about another coming, and that's the second coming. So what I want to talk to you today about is, remember the promise box, and remember that God's word is filled with promises. He gives three promises today in Malachi, and I want to read Malachi 4, verses 1 through 3. Stand, if you would, for the reading of God's word. For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, and all the proud, yes, all who do wickedly will be stubble. And the day which is coming shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, that will leave them neither root nor branch. But to you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings, and you shall go out and grow fat like stall-fed calves. You may be seated. First of all, the first promise is you don't need any diet. I promise you'll be fat. And I believe that promise has worked very well for me. I don't know how it's done for you, but there it is right there in God's word. Now, the first promise I want to talk about is the day is coming. It's the last book of the Old Testament. Malachi is closing up everything that's been written. And he's saying, you remember how everything started. And he said, in creation, God created, the Garden of Eden was perfect, His people were so blessed, they sinned, they were cursed, they repented, and they were blessed. And this was the history of Israel is cyclical, meaning it goes just like this, over and over and over. They keep doing the same things over and over. But the history of the rest of the world is linear. Do you have that for me, Chris, that you can put up so I can show you what I'm talking about? Now, I wrote this, so I hope you can read it. Creation started here. I don't know how long ago that was, but I know that at 4 BC, we believe that Jesus was born. You say, wait, wouldn't that have been at zero? Isn't that? No, he probably was born 4 years before the calendar was put together. At 29 AD, Jesus died. There's been almost 2,000 years. 2029 will be exactly 2,000 years. And the thing we know is this. We know there was a beginning, and we know there is an end. We know that day is coming. Now the question is, when? When's that going to happen? Okay, you can take it off. I don't know. And guess what? Jesus doesn't either. Only God knows. And at some point, he's going to say, Jesus, go get my people. I'm ready for them. I'm just curious, where do you think we are if you look at that line and you look at the end? Where do you think we are? How close do you think we are? Look around the world right now. Do you see anything that's just crazy? Do you see anything that's just evil? I see people that are evil. And I don't understand how, if you can help me understand this, how sending some people to New York on a bus, they get 300 people and they're just beside themselves. They don't know what to do. And they need some federal funding to handle those. But yet, 4,000 a day are coming in at our border. Our world is in a mess. The promise that Malachi says is the day of the Lord is coming. That day, it's coming. And the fact is, I believe this promise. I believe Jesus is going to return. I believe he's coming in the clouds. And I believe that all Christians, all of his, are going to be lifted up. Second, he says this. I promise an oven. That doesn't affect us. But it kind of does if you look at it this way. I asked Amy to put on the front of the bulletin a refiner's fire. And what that is a fire that if you were to take a gold nugget and put it in the fire, all impurities would burn out and you would have a 0.999 piece of gold. Okay? The value of that piece of gold is so much more than it was when it had all the impurities in it. Now look at your life. Sometimes we go through some difficult circumstances. Some really frustrating things happen. I look at some of the people in our church and what they're going through, and I think of Steve and Diane, Sam's. And I think of all the things Steve has gone through when they were telling him, this is probably going to help you and you're going to get much better. And it's like just one thing after another. And the frustration that a family feels. Part of that is refining. Part of that is taking out some of the impurities. Because I can tell you, when God is refining us, our focus is so much better because it's all on Him at that point. I know I can't do it. I have to depend upon Him. And so as I look at what some people are going through, if we see it as refining and we see it as the oven, think of it like we do here in Kansas. What's the purpose of the stubble in the fields of the wheat after it's cut? It's worthless. Now, if you've ever walked through a field, it can be painful on your feet. Never want to do it barefooted. But we burn that stubble, and we find out that it's now ready to replant, and we can start all over. New life begins. What he's talking about here, when he's talking about burning the stubble, he said, I'm going to take the people who have absolutely no desire to have anything to do with me, and they are going to be burned up forever. He's talking about a place called hell. I was playing golf a couple weeks ago on a Tuesday, and a guy asked me, he said, you ever preach about hell? And I said, why? No, most people don't think that exists. Why would I talk about that? And which was a great conversation starter, by the way. But, yes, I do believe in a literal hell. And I believe the promise here is there is going to be an oven. He says it. There's going to be an oven. When's it going to happen? I don't know. But I do know this, when Jesus comes, some are going to be left behind. Third thing I want to share is this. I promise my people will arise with healing in the wings. So if the first promise is true, and if it's not, none of this matters, okay? If the first promise is true and Jesus is coming back, then it says he's going to lift us up. We're going to arise with healing in our wings, meaning when we get there, we get a new body. I don't understand this new body. I don't fully grasp it, except this I do know about this body. It's not going to hunger. It's not going to thirst. It's not going to desire sleep. It's going to be a body that knows how to praise the Lord. That's all I know about it. I don't know what it's going to look like. I'm assuming I'm going to be handsome as heck. I don't know for sure. But probably be my desire anyway. Now, when I think of this and I think of heaven, the first thought I have is, I want to make sure I go there. I want to make sure I'm ready. Because if this is true, and Jesus is coming back, and I'm not ready, being left behind would be the worst thing that ever happened to anyone. Nothing worse. The promises of Malachi are given to us for this purpose. Here's the promises. If you believe them, and you're on this line, and you know it's happening at some point, and it's amazing how many people have thought it was in their lifetime, and it was not. I think it's going to be in the next generation's lifetime, not mine, but I don't know that for sure. But I can see what's happening in the world, and I would say, with some type of certainty, we're a lot closer than any generation before us. When I see what's happening in the world, I mean, we've become a TikTok generation, and the TikTok, 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 TikTok means Jesus is about done with us. And if that's true, then the choice is totally up to you. Are you ready? Because it could be any day now. Are you ready? Stand with me this morning. Hymn number 488. Someone asked 2 weeks ago, how do you choose your sermons? And a lot of times my sermon comes out of something that happens maybe during the week. And so I want to show you this. Let me have Judd just a minute. Come here, bud. I got to know this little boy really well this week, didn't I, buddy? Huh? And in getting to know this boy, I start realizing, what does the future look like for this little kid? What happens when this generation grows up with the way things are going on now? Will he be woke? Because I never will be. And as I think about that, and I think about Jesus returning, I know every little kid's going, but something happened. We voted in the state of Kansas that these don't matter. And it makes me sick. How do you think it makes God feel? And so as I think about that, I can't help but think Jesus is coming back. I just want to make sure that as I preach to you, you understand this is important. This matters. Our grandchildren matter. Our children matter. Our great-grandchildren, they matter. Those in the womb, they matter. And we have to preach and teach that this all matters. Jesus is real, and he's really coming back. You believe that, buddy? Okay. All right. Let me hand him back. Let's close with prayer. There's just something about holding a baby and seeing that baby look into your eyes and know that he trusts you. Lord, as we look into your eyes, I want to trust you. You're my Father. And as I look in your eyes, I feel like there's tears. As you wept over Jerusalem, I believe you weep over babies that are being killed. I believe you weep over evil that's being done. And I believe, Jesus, you are coming back soon. I pray that we are ready. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
There's still neon in these paints. There's still an echo in these veins. It's the past that I've been haunted by. The things I thought I wanted, I never should have wondered. I let the devil get the best of me. When oh my God's paid a debt for me. Ghost.